And now to our newsmaker to discuss his abrupt removal as the Bishop of Memphis and his thoughts on this abuse scandal and much more. Please welcome Bishop Martin Holley exclusively to the program. Your Excellency, thank you for being here.
Thank you so much.
I wish you were here under happier circumstances. Absolutely. Tell me what happened. In the reporting on your removal, we are told that you were removed because there was concern about major changes you had made in the diocese. You moved about 26 priests around, and there was naturally some discomfort with that. Sure. Is that why you were removed?
Well, you know, Raymond, I wonder if that is the case, because how can you, you know, not move? You know, you have seven people five people who are retiring, two are going away. Mm-hmm. That creates, you know, seven vacancies. And then that creates, you know, another seven. Mm-hmm. And it just begins that tumble effect. Mm-hmm. You know, this visitation, you know, to me was to assist me, it said, in the operation of the diocese.
Yeah, they sent in apostolic visitation, which is a formal visitation by the Vatican. Absolutely. But you were told what about that visitation?
I was told nothing at all about the visitation whatsoever. I have no report whatsoever.
Nothing in writing?
Nothing in writing whatsoever. I was just told, I was given an envelope, and all of a sudden, I had 24 hours or less to prepare for the visitation. I was told that I could also get a list of people that I wanted interviewed, so I had to go about trying to do that. Hmm. Apparently, whoever it was had already gathered the names of disgruntled clergy, you know.
The people who instigated this investigation, because usually it comes after a petition to the Holy See.
Absolutely.
So someone had petitioned it, probably
clergy? Well, there
were
letters. Yeah, and I would think, you know, Monsignor, you know, Peter Belcanani, because he had met with some of the disgruntled priests at the time, you know. But I think this is latent with, you know, some racism, privilege, you know. You know, people who were used to being in place and so forth and not wanting to move, you know, Monsignor, you know, MacArthur as well, you know. I mean, I'm edified, you know, that people love their pastor, but as bishop, I was doing only the things that a bishop would do.
Your Excellency, you were an auxiliary here in Washington, D.C.
Yes,
you were for 12 years. Right. How many years were you in Memphis?
I was in Memphis 2 years.
2 years? Only 2 years?
Yeah, right before my anniversary, I get this information.
Wow. Mm-hmm. Tell me how you learned that you were being removed. Did you get a formal letter from the Congregation of Bishops? What happened?
I received a letter, you know, from Archbishop Cristo Pierre.
Who's the nuncio, the Vatican ambassador in D.C.
This summer at the Bishops' Conference. Uh-huh. And so I read it, and I was given the opportunity again to, you know, to have 24 hours to be able to gather the people who would speak on my behalf.
But apparently, that's about the investigation. Right. How did you learn of your removal?
I learned of my removal when I was on a plane. I touched down here in Washington. Actually, I was on my way to Baltimore, and I received, you know, email from the nuncio wanting me to acknowledge, you know, the fact that I was going to be removed. I met him previously the week before in Chicago in an airport, and he said to me that the Holy Father wants me to resign. I was shocked, and I said, why? I haven't done anything wrong. Yeah. And so he mentioned your vicar general, meaning Father Machado. Mm-hmm. And I said, he resigned. He's away.
Studying, you know, canon law.
Canon law. And I said, you know, he says he wants you to become Bishop Emeritus. I said, but there hasn't been any canonical process in this at all. So I didn't understand that. I was shocked.
And you still have no explanation.
I have no explanation whatsoever. I said to him, I said, you know, I have a right to appeal. He said, there is no appeal. And I said, why? You know, I said, I want my voice to be heard.
Well, you have a due process that you should be afforded, like any other bishop or priest or laity in the church.
I wanted to be clear. I never said no to the Holy Father's request at all. What I said is, I feel that my voice has not been heard. Yeah, I would never do that.
So, how do you explain your removal? You believe that this may be an act of revenge.
It could be, I believe, because Monsignor Peter Belcanani and maybe even Bishop Stein, you know, and it may be also...
Who's your predecessor.
Yes, in conjunction, you know, with the nuncio, for whatever reason it may be, is that Monsignor Buchanani and Cardinal Wuerl have been friends ever since they were in seminary together.
Ah.
It goes way back. Mm-hmm. And I think somewhere along the line, because I, you know, was making progress and doing the things that I was supposed to be doing, mm-hmm. that he didn't like that.
Wuerl didn't like it.
I don't think Monsignor Peter Buchanani, I don't think he liked it at mm-hmm. all as well as mm-hmm.
Because you Cardinal. Invited Cardinal Wuerl, who you served under here in Washington, D.C.
I did.
As an auxiliary in Washington. Right. You invited him to Memphis to speak on several occasions.
I did.
Yeah.
I sure did.
You believe that there's an event that happened in 2012 that might have soured his perception of you.
I was asked by the Holy Father, Pope Benedict, mm-hmm. at that time, as I said to Catholic News Agency, mm-hmm. I was asked to give a testimony as to the suitability, you know, of his being considered for Secretary of State at that time. And I provided that. Mm. And of course, it didn't happen. I don't know if because of my, you know, suggestions or recommendations, but it didn't happen.
Mm.
Yeah.
What was your relationship with Wuerl as an auxiliary?
Well, you know, I've always respected him, mm-hmm. but, you know, we've had our moments, yeah. you know, mm-hmm. but
of disagreement.
In mm-hmm. private, you yeah. know, there was a particular moment, you know, when one of our priests, you know, said that he made a racist statement. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, the cardinal was very upset and he says, I'm not a racist. And the priest said, you know, I didn't say that. I said that was a racist statement. So he ended mm-hmm. the meeting, and clearly he was very upset. Mm-hmm. And he said, I have never been accused of being a racist, and no one came to my defense. Well, he looked right at me when mm-hmm. he said that. Later on, we had a meeting with this priest. I didn't want to be there. The priest wanted to be there, mm-hmm. you know, as support for him, but I was there in a neutral position.
Yeah.
You know. Mm. And I'm not saying the cardinal is a racist, but, you know, what I'm saying is, you know, the relationship, you know, could have been better than what it is.
What about McCarrick? You served under Cardinal McCarrick. He ordained you to be a bishop. Did you ever see any of the abuse that we're now learning of, or any signs of that?
No idea whatsoever. I feel so bad for the victims, mm-hmm. you know, it is very, very sad for them. And I pray for them. I pray for their healing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Since, that should never go on.
Since you've made these allegations that perhaps your removal was retributive mm-hmm. and that Cardinal Wuerl might be behind it, there has come forward these allegations from 2009, a mm-hmm. blog. Yeah. Where a seminarian said that you invited some kind of sexual favor upon him. You have denied those allegations.
Well, you know, it was after I made, you know, a testimony against same-sex marriage here in Washington, D.C. Mm. to the city council that blog went up. I find that quite interesting, mm-hmm. you know, that something like that would come out.
And did you, you claimed you took those allegations, you informed Cardinal Wuerl, Bishop Barry Nestout of those.
Absolutely.
They claim they were not informed of that.
Well, I did inform them. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I wanted to be totally transparent because when it came to my attention, you know, I went immediately to them because they were my superiors.
Are you surprised that here you sit, having attempted, and look, I've spoken to people, I will tell you in full disclosure, people in Memphis, mm-hmm. people in Washington, some of your confreres at the Bishop's Conference.
Sure.
Near as I can figure it out, you were trying to right a ship that was a little off course in Memphis, let's be honest.
I'd say a lot off course,
okay.
if you ask me.
Yeah.
There are quite a few things, especially in the tribunal, was my mm-hmm. major concern, you know, because of the fact that it was understaffed. And that was a reason why Father Machado, I brought him in, because he was in canon law studies.
Right.
Father, you know, James Clark was sent away. Father Donato was, mm-hmm. you know, studying online.
And Father Clement Machado, our audience will know him. Yeah. He's been on television here for a number of years.
Yeah.
An exorcist, somebody who's, you know, very outspoken. And you brought him in from Canada.
Yeah.
And there were some noses out of joint in Memphis that you brought a man in from Canada.
Sure. But I want to focus in on, you know, the cases. Mm-hmm. The cases in the tribunal, you know, they were just given out, I think, you know, in terms of their sentences and so forth, I felt, you know, as I just looked at a few of them, that they probably should not have been granted, and I was concerned about that. As a matter of fact, I had someone to consult on that area, and I put a hold on everything because I needed to do a further, deeper examination of the tribunal itself.
Might that be part of the reason that you were removed, that you were on the precipice of discovering something there?
That and other things as well.
In the diocese?
In the diocese, yeah.
Why are you coming forward now, Bishop Holley? This can't be an easy... I've known you for a number of years.
Yeah.
You're not a showboater. You're not somebody who likes to, you know, run around the media. Why are you coming forward now? What do you hope to accomplish?
I just want my story to be told. I want the Holy Father to know the truth, because I don't feel that I have been given justice. I don't think there was a, you know, the process was fair. I think it's unjust, you know. And so somewhere along the line, I feel that the communication has not really gotten to the Holy Father. And this is the only way that I can get to him. I love the Holy Father. I pray for him. I will do whatever he's asking me to do. And I did exactly that. I was asked through that letter, through the nuncio. I've gotten out of the way. I would never do anything. I love the priests who are there.
Yeah.
I have no animosity. I pray for them.
Yeah, but you need to be given, you need to be furnished as a, as a bishop and as a man. What are the charges? Why am I being removed now? And give me due process. I mean, I have to tell you, just the bit I know about this case, it offends me as a Catholic and as a man that this is happening to anybody. I mean, look, I've known priests who've been charged. Some have turned out to be guilty of things. But they demand and we need due process for everybody. Then if you're guilty, bye-bye. But
if I was a bishop, I'd be concerned.
Exactly.
I'm a bishop. I'm concerned. My brother bishops should be concerned. A priest should be concerned.
Right.
You know, a due process is only fair. Tell me, what is it that I've done that I should be abruptly, you know, kicked out of my diocese and told to resign and become a bishop emeritus?
Do you find it curious, at a time when we're talking about accompaniment, having a spirit of mercy, walking with people who need our assistance, that none of that was afforded to you?
Well, you know, my Episcopal motto is, His mercy endures forever, okay? And again, I have no animosity against my brother priest, any bishops or anyone, Cardinal Wolf, Monsignor Buchanan, any of them. But I want the truth to be told. That is why I'm here.
Yeah.
I have a reputation, and the people who know me know that I am not that type of person that is being portrayed, and that is why I'm here.
This is why this whole case, something smells fishy here, and and you deserve answers. And at this point, so do we and the people of Memphis. Do you hope your brother bishops will speak out and plead your case as you would plead theirs?
I would hope so, because I think this is an injustice. You know, at this point, you know, I don't feel that I've been given due justice, due process, canonical at all. You know.
Bishop Holley, thank you for being here, for being so candid. We'll keep you in our prayers, and we'll check in with you soon.